Good morning again. Isn't it good to be here?
Amen.
Aren't you thankful to be in the house of the Lord today? I am. And you know, just a week ago we were finishing off camming, 4.5 days of preaching on perfection and the ability to overcome sin and to walk a righteous, holy life. And boy, a lot's been going on in the last week since that time. And maybe we've been up on a high mountaintop and we've come down to the valley for a while. But friends, if we have, it's time to get back up to the mountaintop. We can do this and we can be there. And God can help us. We were talking about Christian perfection last week. And this Wednesday night, I talked about perfection of character, Appendix A. Remember? We talked about that Wednesday night. And I said we'd talk about Appendix B today. And I started off by sharing, I finished off Wednesday night as a prelude to today by sharing a statement about John Quincy Adams. He was the 6th President of the United States. And John Quincy Adams, let me just hold off on that, but he held more important offices than anyone else in the history of the United States. He served not only as president, but he was a senator, a congressman, secretary of state to President Monroe. He was ambassador to Russia and many different countries in Europe. He participated in various capacities of the American Revolution, the War of 1812. In fact, he bartered the peace treaty for the War of 1812, and even was involved in events leading to the Civil War. He was he really spoke against slavery very strongly. He did many different things that were beneficial to our country. And yet at age 70, he wrote the following. He said, "My whole life has been a succession of disappointments. I can scarcely recollect a single instance of success in anything that I ever undertook." Now, it's true that if you look at his presidency, his presidency is probably rated in the lower half as far as accomplishments. But when you look at his life as a Secretary of State, as an ambassador, especially as a congressman after he was president, he accomplished a great deal, seemingly that was very successful. But perhaps the reason that Quincy Adams would say something like this is found in one of the letters he wrote to one of his sons. He was serving as ambassador to Russia, and this was in September of 1811, and he penned this to one of his sons. He says, "I have for many years made it a practice to read through the Bible once a year. My custom is to read 4 or 5 chapters every morning immediately after rising from my bed. It employs about an hour of my time." Now, if it took him an hour to read 4 or 5 chapters, most likely he was doing more than just reading to get through, wouldn't you say?
Yeah.
"It employs about an hour of my time and seems to me the most suitable manner of beginning the day. In what light soever we regard the Bible, whether with reference to revelation, to history, or to mortality, it is an invaluable and inexhaustible mine of knowledge and virtue." And then he continues, "Let us then search the scriptures. The Bible contains the revelation of the will of God. It contains the history of the creation of the world." He didn't believe in evolution, did he? "It contains the history of the world, the creation of the world of mankind, afterward the history of one peculiar nation, certainly the most extraordinary nation that has ever appeared upon the earth." And that was written from Russia in 1811. In other words, John Quincy Adams, he allowed the Bible to rule his life and to direct him in all that he did. And I believe that as he studied the Bible, as he read that Bible through, he understood certain maxims and points about the Bible. One is the humility that must be a part of our Christian experience. If we read the Bible daily and compare our lives to the great divine measuring rod of truth and righteousness, we might tend to feel as Adams too. There's a text in Isaiah chapter 64. I think you're well familiar with it. But in Isaiah chapter 64 and verse 6, notice what the prophet here has written. Isaiah chapter 64 and verse 6. "But we are as an unclean thing, and all our righteousnesses are as filthy rags, and we do all fade as a leaf, and our iniquities like the wind have taken us away." We spoke a lot about perfection of character. We spoke a lot about righteousness by faith. We spoke about overcoming sin. But we need to keep paramount also, friends, involved in all of this that there is an attitude of humility, an attitude of humbleness, that we recognize that of ourselves, we are nothing. We have nothing good to offer God. All of our righteousnesses are simply as a filthy rag. They amount to nothing. They're no good. They are wasteful. In the book Steps to Christ, on pages 28 and 29, we are told, "We may have flattered ourselves, as did Nicodemus, that our life has been upright, that our moral character is correct, and think that we need not humble the heart before God, like the common sinner. But when the light from Christ shines into our souls, we shall see how impure we are. We shall discern the selfishness of motive, the enmity against God that has defiled every act of life. Then we shall know that our own righteousness is indeed as filthy rags, and that the blood of Christ alone can cleanse us from the defilement of sin and renew our hearts in His own likeness." Steps to Christ, pages 28 and 29. If we could turn to Romans chapter 10, I'd like to share a text in Romans chapter 10 and verse 3. Let me just read verses 1 and 2 so we get the context. He says, "Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness, and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God." And herein lies the trap that is so easy to fall into, the track of truth that lies so close beside the track of error. Because he's speaking about Israel and how they wanted the righteousness of God. And you remember that they specialized in works, didn't they? They specialized in what they could do and in keeping the law. And yet, in Psalms 119 and verse 172, he says, "All thy commandments are what? Righteousness." I read a study recently about the righteousness of God, and it began with a difficult dictionary lexicon definition of righteousness. But really, friends, the simplest definition of righteousness is found in the book Christ Object Lessons, and simply says that righteousness is right doing. Now, you can get all the lexicons, you can get all the dictionaries you want, and you can find a lot of definitions for what righteousness is. But in the most simplest form, righteousness is right doing. All His commandments are righteousness. And yet, this righteousness of God, which comes by faith, is what the Jews looked for, but they looked for it how? Not through by faith, but by their own works. And our own righteousness, doing the things in our own hands, in our own ways of ourselves, is nothing but filthy rags. And so are we ignorant of God's righteousness? Or do we have a better handle on this? Well, we might think we do. We might have a better handle intellectually. But friends, if we don't have it experientially in our lives, if it doesn't become a part of our fiber and our very being, then it's not what God wants us to have. One of my favorite parables is found in the book of Luke. If we could turn to chapter 18 in Luke. I love the teachings of Jesus because they're so simple. They're usually not long. They're usually not elaborating too detailed in things, but they speak volumes in just a few words. No one can speak like Jesus. I can talk to you for hours. In fact, if you want me to preach all day, that's easy to do. Start right now. But Jesus could say in a few words, power-packed, dynamic things. And in Luke chapter 18, beginning in verse 9, he spake this parable unto certain which trusted in themselves that they were, what? Righteous, and despised others. Now, if they believed they were righteous, they believed they had righteousness. Would that be right? Sure. Verse 2, or verse 10. Two men went up into the temple to pray. The one a Pharisee, the other, what? A publican. Now, who were publicans?
Tax collectors.
Just like today, they were the esteemed of a society, right? They were people just well loved. You know, if you have caller ID and you saw a phone number come up and the phone's ringing, and on the other side on caller ID it said IRS, wouldn't your heart probably just sink for a minute? You don't expect the IRS just to call you to say howdy doody or to wish you a good day, do you? Something's wrong. Your heart begins to race a little bit. You're quivering as you pick up the phone. Well, this was a publican, and he wasn't probably much better liked. The Pharisee, verse 11, stood and prayed thus with himself, "God, I thank thee that I'm not as other men are, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this publican, this tax collector. And then he goes on to tell us how good he is. I believe in health reform. That's right, I fast twice a week. I'm faithful in my stewardship. I give tithes of all that I possess. And the publican, standing afar off, would not lift up so much as his eyes into heaven, but smote upon his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. And Jesus tells us that this man went down to his house justified, or made righteous. The word righteous and justified in these verses is the same word. One's just simply a noun form, and the other is a verb form of the word. He went down to his house justified. He went down to his house made righteous. And what did he simply ask for? He asked for one thing. He asked for mercy. And God gave him that mercy. And this is the righteousness that we need, the righteousness that comes through faith in Christ. Now let me ask you a question. The publicans were known for their extortion, their cheating, their thievery. Do you suppose that publican went out and kept practicing extortion? Do you suppose he kept bribing, taking bribes and stealing from the people? If he received the righteousness of Christ, friends, his life changed, didn't it? Because true faith works. We talk about faith and works, but the thing is, true faith works. It works by love and purifies us all. Galatians chapter 5 and verse 6. In Philippians chapter 3, Paul here gives a little bit of his experience. Philippians chapter 3, and I'm going to start in verse 4. Philippians chapter 3 and verse 4. He says, though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if any other man thinketh that he hath whereof he might trust in the flesh, I more. Paul is almost bragging here. He says, if you think you've got something to brag about, I've got it and I've got more. If this is what obtains righteousness for us, I've got it. In verse 5, I was circumcised the eighth day of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, and Hebrew of the Hebrews, as touching the law, a Pharisee. That meant, friends, that he was meticulous. He believed in the little things. He believed in everything that possibly could be done. Verse 7. But what things were gain to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, or refuge, dung, that I may win Christ, and be found in Him, not having mine own righteousness. And what was Paul's righteousness like? Well, he says it was a Pharisee. He said it was good righteousness. Friends, it was righteousness so good that he was going to murder the saints. Isn't that right? Paul was involved in genocide. He was involved in genocide. Like Hitler or others. His genocide was against the people of God. And if Jesus had not arrested him and woke him up, friends, he would have continued. Because he was zealous for the law. He was a Pharisee, as touching the law, blameless. He was going to fulfill the letter of the law, and he was going to eradicate this sect that was taking away the righteousness that he had, the righteousness that he believed all of God's people needed. But Paul says, that's not the righteousness that would avail me. He said, to be found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know Him and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His sufferings, being made conformable unto His death. Paul understood that his righteousness that he thought was righteousness was but filthy rags, and it wasn't enough. And he understood that there was a claim upon him by Christ, but there was also a claim that he understood, a claim that John understood, a claim that the Bible writers understood that we are never to make. And that claim's in 1 John chapter 1, verse 8. 1 John chapter 1 and verse 8. 1 John chapter 1, verse 8. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. We believe in character perfection, friends. We believe that God can give us grace to overcome sin. But here it says that if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. Now notice the language of the Bible, because we're going to come back to this in a minute. It doesn't say if we have no sin. It says if we say we have no sin. Verse 10, if we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. Now the Bible says that Job was a man. It says he was a good man. In fact, what kind of a man does the Bible say he was? He was a good, he was a perfect and upright man, a man who sheweth evil. And who said that Job was a perfect man? Was it his contemporaries? God himself said it, didn't he? He said it to Satan. He said, if you consider my Job, he is a perfect man. But let's notice what Job said about himself. In Job chapter 9. Job chapter 9. In verse 20. This is Job's response to Bildad. And he says here, if I justify myself, mine own mouth shall condemn me. If I say I am perfect, it shall also prove me perverse. Job understood that though a person could reach character perfection, they would never claim this. They would never, from their mortal lips, ever say, I am sinless, I am perfect, I am holy. In Proverbs chapter 20, we have a question. Proverbs chapter 20 and verse 9. Who can say, I have made my heart clean? I am pure from my sin. The implied answer is, friends, nobody can say that. We of ourselves can do nothing. We may not wish that to be the case, but it doesn't change the reality. It doesn't change the reality. Have you ever seen a Rolls Royce? One of the most expensive cars in the world, one of the most well-built cars in the world, has one of the best reputations in the world. An Englishman had bought a Rolls Royce, and he was going through the Alps, through Switzerland. And he was moving the car quite fast through those tight turns as only a car this well-made could go. And all of a sudden, clunk, bump, and the car almost lost control. A front spring had broke. And so he limped into where he was going easily. And so he called. He called the nearest place he could contact Rolls-Royce by in England, explained what happened. And the next day, a gentleman came from Rolls-Royce, brought tools, brought a spring, fixed the car, and left. So the man finished his time in Switzerland, eventually made it back into England, and while he was in England, he realized he'd never gotten a bill yet. And so he called Rolls-Royce up. I'm calling, he says, about the Swiss repair, the broken spring. A few minutes later, the man on the other line said, there must be some mistake, sir. There's no such thing as a broken spring on a Rolls-Royce. Well, they might not like to think so, huh? We might not like to think that our conditions are really what they are. But friends, the best thing we can do is owe up to our condition, to owe up to our wretchedness and our selfishness and what we need. In Hosea chapter 12, if we would turn there, right after the book of Daniel, makes it easy to find. If we can find Daniel, most of us can, I think. In chapter 12, in verse 8. Hosea, chapter 12, and verse 8. And Ephraim said, yet I am become rich. I have found me out substance. In all my labors, they shall find none iniquity in me that were sin. That's what Ephraim says. Do you think it's painting a picture of reality? In this same book, this same author, chapter 4 and verse 17, he says, Ephraim is joined into his idols. Let him alone. Ephraim might thought he was fine, but he wasn't at all. In Proverbs chapter 16, Proverbs chapter 16 and verse 2, Anybody remember what Proverbs is? Right after what book? Psalms, that's right. Proverbs 16 and verse 2. All the ways of man are clean in his own eyes, but the Lord weigheth the spirits. How do we generally see ourselves? In the best light. As we mentioned, there was a survey done about work around the house. They asked the housewife, how much of the work do you do around here? At least 90%. They ask the men, how much housework do you do around the house? Oh, I do a lot. At least 40%. You know, those don't add up to 100%, do they? We like to look upon ourselves in the best light, usually, in the most favorable light. And that's what it says here in this text. All the ways of man are clean in his own eyes, but the Lord weigheth the spirits. And the Lord weighs it by the same standard, friends, we may weigh it by. And that is his word. His word tells us what the real situation is, if we will do it. Sometimes we live in a country today in America. And I'm going to mention a word, and I think each one of you will probably know what this word means. Entitlement. Or entitlements. Our government today is very big on what they call entitlements. In other words, everybody is entitled to certain things in life. And if you cannot produce the life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness on your own, it's the government's responsibility to help you because you are entitled to it. And therefore, if you don't work, you get a check. If you're sick, you get a check. If you just don't want to work, it seems like you get a check. You're entitled to it. We want what we're entitled to, whether we work for it or not sometimes. That's the way we feel. And Israel had that problem too. And they had it spiritually as well. In Deuteronomy chapter 9. But God tries to nip this in the bud. Deuteronomy chapter 9. In verse 4. It says, speak not thou in thine heart, after that the Lord thy God hath cast them out from before thee, saying, for my righteousness the Lord hath brought me in to possess this land. But for the wickedness of these nations, the Lord doth drive them out from before thee. God promised to take the children of Israel to the promised land, right? But there were people living there already, and they were extremely wicked people, vile people. And God says, we have to move them out so we can move you in. But don't think I'm putting you in here because you're so much better than they are. I want to ask you a question. Is there a parallel between the Exodus and the Advent? Is there? Yes, of course there are many, many parallels. Does this specific parallel hold? Is God going to take us to the heavenly Canaan without us being really good, though? No, he's not. No, he's not, friends. And herein lies the paradox. Herein lies the paradox. Because I want to know what the same writer who wrote 1 John 1:8 also wrote. Let's turn to 1 John chapter 1, read verses 5 and 6. 1 John chapter 1. Oops, not John, 1 John. First John chapter 1, verses 5 and 6. He says, this, then, is the message which we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. Wait a minute. I thought darkness was a symbol of sin, a symbol of evil. And light is a symbol of truth. It's a symbol of righteousness. But it says that if we walk in darkness, what? We're not in him. He says in verse 7, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ his Son cleanses us from all sin. And then you come to verse 8. But now let's go to chapter 3. In verse 4. Because here we have the definition of sin. And we have more. 1 John chapter 3, verse 4. Whosoever committeth sin transgresses also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law. Verse 4. Whosoever committeth sin verse 5. And ye know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him is no sin. Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. Is that what it says? Whosoever abides in him sinneth not. And you have a little friend back there flying close to some of you, so just keep your eye out back there. A little friend with a stinger. Okay. Verse 6, whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. Whosoever sinneth hath not seen him, neither known him. Little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he, as Christ, is righteous. Verse 8, he that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin because he is born of God. Friends, here we have a paradox. How do we put 1 John chapter 3 and verse 9 together with 1 John chapter 1 verse 8? 1 John chapter 1, verse 8 says that if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. This text says that if we are born of God, if we are in Christ, that we cannot sin, that we do not sin. It seems that we have here a paradox. But I believe that there is a solution to this. I think that we can go to a few texts and we can see it. In Philippians chapter 2, we were in Philippians earlier. Let's go back. Philippians chapter 2, verse 3, it says, let nothing be done through strife or vainglory. Philippians 2, 3. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind let each esteem other better than themselves. How are we to look at other people as better than ourselves? It says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Verse 5, who being in the form of God thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. Paul is saying here to us that we are not to have a sense of superiority to anyone, but rather the opposite, that we are to have the understanding that others are better than us, others are ahead of us. And it has to do with attitude. Remember in 1 John chapter 1, verse 8, it says that if we say we have no sin, it doesn't say that we can't have sin. But it says that our attitude is going to be one of humility, that we would never claim to be holy. We would never claim to be righteous. I think of the Laodicean church. They fail to acknowledge that they are wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. And that is the problem. God can take care of their blindness, can't he? I mean, when Jesus was on the earth, he not only healed the people of physical blindness, but He brought great light to the people. He brought revelation to them. There are people who are naked, but Jesus can provide clothing. He can provide clothing for Adam and Eve. He can provide the robe of our righteousness, that pure righteousness. We don't think we have any, we think we have discernment, but we don't, but he can provide discernment for us. He is our righteousness, our wisdom, 1 Corinthians 1:31. He's everything for us. He is the power of God and the wisdom of God. Laodicea needs the gold tried in the fire, the white raiment, the discernment of the Spirit of God, and he offers it to us. And whether we receive it or not, friends, is going to depend a lot upon our attitude. Our attitude. Attitude means everything. Our perception and perceptive understanding of what he wants to do in us and through us. There's a little section in the book Acts of the Apostles. I think everyone here probably has read it more than once, but I think it's so apropos, I want to read it again. This is from Acts of the Apostles, pages 561 and 562. None of the apostles and prophets ever claimed to be without sin. Men who have lived the nearest to God, men who would sacrifice life itself rather than knowingly commit a wrong act, men whom God has honored with divine light and power have confessed the sinfulness of their nature. They have put no confidence in the flesh, have claimed no righteousness of their own, but have trusted wholly in the righteousness of Christ. Continuing. So it will be with all who behold Christ. The nearer we come to Jesus, and the more clearly we discern the purity of his character, the more clearly shall we see the exceeding sinfulness of sin. and the less we shall feel like exalting ourselves. There will be a continual reaching out of the soul after God, a continual, earnest, heartbreaking confession of sin and humbling of the heart before Him. At every advanced step in our Christian experience, our repentance will deepen. Let me just pause there for a minute. At every advanced what? Step. When you have steps, that means you don't get there from point A to point B in one step, do you? It's a progression. Sanctification, friends, is a work of a lifetime. Continuing, it says, we shall know that our sufficiency is in Christ alone, and shall make the apostles' confession our own. I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. God forbid that I should glory, save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. Romans 7:18, Galatians 6:14. Let the recording angels write the history of the holy struggles and conflicts of the people of God. Let them record their prayers and tears. Friends, we need to pray, and sometimes we need to pray with tears, and that's okay. It says, let them record their prayers and tears, but let not God be dishonored by the declaration from human lips, I am sinless, I am holy. Sanctified lips will never give utterance to such presumptuous words. The Apostle Paul had been caught up to the third heaven and had seen and heard things that could not be uttered. And yet his unassuming statement is, not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after. Philippians 3:12. And so let's go back to Philippians, if we're close by there. Philippians chapter 3. And let's read again verses 10, and now 12, and 11 in between with it. Paul says that I may know him, and the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of his sufferings, be made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might obtain unto the resurrection of the dead, not as though I had already obtained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Paul could later say in his second epistle to Timothy, I have fought a good fight, I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give to me at that day, not to me only, but to all those also who shall love his appearing. Paul never claimed perfection of the flesh, but he said God had done a good work in him. And that's the key, friends. If we will let God do a good work in us, if we will surrender our lives to him, we may have to hold on to that golden cord let down from heaven. He's not going to put a lasso around us and take us without our agreeing to it, without our holding on to the cable. But he'll give us the strength to do that. And sometimes he has to take away from us everything that we have. And we know eventually everything that we have is going to be lost. It's going to be taken away totally. So we should be willing to let any of it go today and to acknowledge our own unworthiness. And then perfection really can begin in our lives, because then Christ can work in us. And we don't have to have the unrighteousness, the filthy rags any longer. Then, as it shows in Zechariah 3, we can have that beautiful robe of Christ's righteousness placed upon us after the other is taken away. And that's his work, and he'll do it for us. So as we think about this Appendix B, this little cap note on perfection, let us remember, friends, that it is God's will that we walk in perfection. Jesus said, be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. And that's pretty perfect, isn't it? Can we continue in sin and be perfect, friends? No, not at all. But we'll never say that we have no sin. Friends, our attitude will never be one that we are better than other people. Our attitude will never be that we have arrived, that we are equal with God, or any such like thing. But it'll be a continual hungering and thirsting after righteousness. And the closer we keep coming to Jesus, the more unworthy we'll understand how much we are and how much more we need him. Well, this is summertime here in the United States. But if you're in the southern hemisphere, it happens to be winter time now. And when we have winter here, one thing we get is snow. Do you like snow? Some of us don't care so much for snow. We saw pictures of snow up on top of Pikes Peak today in the Sabbath school class. I've been to Pikes Peak, but I just happened to be there when it was the summer of the summer, and the snow was pretty much all gone. It was beautiful up there. The snow-covered mountains are beautiful. You go to Mount Everest, you go to Mount McKinley, you go to Rainier and some of those mountains, there's never a time there's not snow there. But it has its own place, it has its own beauty. And the Lord says, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. And so God uses the snow as an illustration of how white and how pure we can be. Because after all, you know, the snow really doesn't have any color at all, does it? It only looks white. What's snow made of?
Water.
It's frozen water, isn't it? But it reflects the light. We know that all the colors of light combined in the additive color process make white light. And that's why the snow looks white to us. You can take it and you can melt it into a jar and it's clear. But the reality will be, in our case, that we really will be white. We really will have that righteousness. May God bless you each, friends, to find that righteousness. I just want to appeal to you, if you've not come to that righteousness of Christ, that He wants you to have it today, and you can have it today. And all you have to do is be like that publican, and smote upon your breast, and just simply ask, God, be merciful to me, a sinner, and He will help you, and He will help you right early. May the Lord add His blessing to the reading of His Word today. Thank you.